Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, I want you to give it up, make a round of applause for the co-creator, executive producer, Snowfall on FX. Give it up for John Singleton, ladies and gentlemen. Let me sit right here, son. Give it up for co-creator, executive producer, David Andron, please. David Andron. You saw him killing it on the screen right there. Damson Idris, Franklin. Franklin City. Teddy McDonald, Carter Hudson, please come on out, sir. There he is. Miss Michael Hyatt. Round of applause. Give it up, give it up. Isaiah John, also Leon Simmons, Cass, there you go. Angela Lewis, round of applause. Aunt Lou, yes she is. Yeah. And Jerome State, also Eamon Joseph. Eamon Joseph, there you are. Yes sir. One more time for the cast, Snowfall Records. You guys look amazing. That was amazing, John. Amazing, David. Amazing. So let's start with John and David, because I know we have limited time tonight. John, why did you feel it was so important to tell this story? I know you're from Los Angeles. I know you lived through this, but...
That's it.
Yeah.
That's it. I'm from L.A., and I've always felt that... there's a whole lot of stories that be told in the city that haven't been told. And, 26 years ago, I made my movie called Boys in the Hood. And I'd always thought about showing Los Angeles before cocaine or crack cocaine hit the streets and what that transition was like. And so a couple of years back, I was trying to figure out what I wanted to do in television, and I could do something very unique and to what I could bring to it, and that's how this idea came about.
David, how did you and John Singleton come together on this?
FX brought it to my attention after Justified. I had worked there for 6 years on that, and that finished up. Thank you very much, both of you. And they said, look, we've got this thing that John and another gentleman named Eric Amadio had written a draft of. And they didn't, they hadn't really done TV. John had directed an episode here and there, but I was kind of brought in to help him figure it out and run the show, and here we are.
Damson, I'm saying your name right?
Yeah.
Okay. You're from the UK?
London, yeah.
London. All right. How'd you prepare? How did you...
So I basically listened. London's very Americanized, so we watch a bunch of American movies. And, I listen to a bunch of hip-hop, Kendrick Lamar, my favorite rapper in the world, and Ice Cube, and Snoop Dogg, Tupac, and then I kind of use them for that twang, and then obviously Denzel Washington to kind of get,
Trade and Day, right?
Yeah.
Let's talk to the feds, man.
Just an actor.
That's what they all say. That's what they all say. How did you prepare for your role? Kappa. Carter, no, seriously, how did you prepare?
It was like a history lesson. It was a lot of reading and a lot of learning about the history of how this all really happened. On one hand, which is a lot of stuff I sadly didn't know a lot about before working on this show. So it was educational for me that way. And then also a lot of just sort of background on, like, what's it like to be a CIA officer? Like, what's it like to, like, how does a CIA officer make breakfast or whatever.
In secret.
Turns out it's pretty much the way I make breakfast, so I wasted a lot of time trying to figure that out.
There's some the women in this very strong. For Angela and Michael, you know, John, you made a great point this morning when you called into the radio show that we don't often hear articulated, which is crack cocaine did something to the black family that slavery and every other way we've been attempted to be torn apart hasn't, which is it made mothers leave their children.
Yes.
It really tore the family apart in a way that never had happened before. Angela and Michael, we'll start with you, Michael. How did, was your real life, did you have any of these real life experiences that you channeled this character that you know, were able to draw from to bring this character to life?
Yes, in that I was raised by a single mother. A single parent. I am a single parent, and that I can relate to, and I'm raising a man child. So I understood the instinct, the organic understanding that you gotta get it done. You have a man to raise, you have a black man to raise, and you must get it done. And failure is not an option. So how you gonna make this work? That I understand. I didn't relate viscerally to the drug drama that's going on, but I don't need to because I'm not a part of that. And as far as I'm concerned, it doesn't exist, right? So far. You know, I feel like the things that I didn't organically understand or I didn't have experience with, there is a universal truth that exists throughout all of these stories, that whether or not you know the specifics of this particular detail, if you're connecting to the universal truth of it, then you're right there.
Yeah.
And Angela, for you, you know, your character makes a decision to stand by her nephew, even when your character decides to send him away. And Angela, talk about that as and what you drew from in your real life to bring that character to life.
Yeah, I think that Louie and I both love hard, real, real, real hard. And I think that Louie doesn't want to see Franklin dead, you know what I mean? And so I think there's two things happening. I think she sees an opportunity. I think Louie is a boss, and she's a boss who historically throughout her life has been told, no, you can't be this, you can't do that, you are not this, you are not that. And so I think she's been heartbroken over and over and over again. And so she sees an opportunity with her nephew, and she wants desperately, I think, to take advantage of that opportunity, but also to do it in a way where she can protect her nephew and love him and do, if he's going to choose this road, this is the way you gotta do it to survive. And she knows that. And so she's gonna do everything she can to make it a win-win.
Amen. Talk about that scene, obviously, where, you know, Franklin comes, and, you know, I'm sure you have young men in your life that have, you know, you were able to pull from, where as a man, as an adult, you had to say, listen, I'm not going to help you do this because this is a big mistake. Because to me, that's a very important scene, right? That is that crossroads that, you know, many families went through, where it was like, look, is making money that important to literally watch, you know, a kid potentially throw his life away? I think that's you know, in our community, that's what it really comes down to for a lot of people who have not, feeling like I need to get money at an excessive level to get out of here, to leave this community behind, to leave this world behind, and not knowing what the ramifications may be. But it seems like you knew what the ramifications, or your character knew what the ramifications were.
Yeah, I feel like that the character Jerome, he lives this, and he sees a potential in Franklin that he wasn't able. First of all, I'm from here. I'm from Harlem, New York. So first of all, I feel really good. We got to get that on. And some of these lessons that, I mean, I got these lessons right here, just for real, like men that were, for lack of a better term, mentors to me. You know, I went to Rice High School right down here off of Nice. And, you know, plenty of times I was a knucklehead doing things, and there were people that, you know, kind of pull your coat up, and they like, listen, you have an opportunity that other people didn't have. There's no need to get that F letter. You know, that's like the scarlet letter for a black man in this country. And I think he sees a lot of potential in Franklin, and there's love, and he's flawed, but he's trying to at least say the right thing. Maybe he's not always living it, but you want to see the next generation do better than you, especially when they're talented, they're young, they're smart, you know, good looking. He has the whole world ahead of him. I'm passing, right? I'm giving a man love, right? He's giving love.
Isaiah, your character, you know, right now we don't really know much. How many people in here have seen Snowfall FX? That's the hashtag, by the way, but how many people have seen it? Isaiah, it seems like your character's shaping up to be a little bit of a troublemaker. But, you know, Franklin, you know, as your friend, you can see that you look up to him in some ways, you know what I mean? And also admire the fact that he gets to live another life part-time. What was your childhood experience, and what did you pull from to create that character?
I mean, for me, I learned by looking at other people's situation. Like, I don't have to necessarily go through something to understand somebody. I'm a very understanding person, you know? So I was able to look at some of the kids that I grew up with, you know, and pull from that, you know, just remembering what would they do in that situation. Like, all right, you know, just being able to put that into my character, and just being able to talk to people like John and Dub C, who was on set every day, like, to help me West Coast that, you know, put that 80s vibe to it. But yeah, I was able to just live through other people and just really understand and connect that way. You know, I didn't necessarily have to go through everything my character went through, obviously, so the fact that I can do that helps me as an actor, you know.
John, when we spoke earlier today, one of the things I'm curious about with where this series goes is, you know, we are watching pre-crack. We know, so we already know, you know.
It's gonna get deep.
It's gonna get crazy, but.
It's gonna get real crazy.
Why did, you know, a lot of times when we see this era, it's already in full swing. We're watching the gangs. We're watching everything get torn apart. We're watching all of it unfold. Why did you pick this period right before?
Well, to put it in context of what was lost, I think you have to show what was lost. And, you know, the decisions that one person makes in their family, you know, could reverberate and change and alter the whole family for the worse, you know, the family and the community. So we're gonna track that out with this particular character.
It feels like also showing his father walking down the street there in the clothes, his mother having to make decisions to keep a job and put on a face, you know, for the man so she could go out every day and make some money are things that actually shape Franklin's anger and posture. And even though he wants to be a good kid, he feels like he needs to do it right now.
Well, I think a lot of people have an emotional identification with the characters in the show because they've either gone through it, or they've seen people go through what these characters have gone through, you know, or heard about something. You know, I do this. We've been speaking at different cities throughout the countries in the last couple weeks, just before the release of the show and after the show. And I always do this to say, how many people in this audience have somebody that was affected by the crack epidemic, either using or been incarcerated or whatever by this stuff? How many people in the audience? So, You know what I mean? Like, and that's just here in Harlem. And everywhere we've gone around the country, it's been a lot of people. So the whole thing of the show, yes, we're here to entertain, and there's some exciting things that happen, but people are kind of emotionally affected by watching it if they're more, if they're embedded, if they've lived it, and they, you know, and they've been affected by it. So you're looking at it on a whole other level in that perspective.
I guess, and before we go to questions in the audience, I'd like to hear from, you know, whoever wants to chime in. In going around and showing this, do you feel like we've learned from this time period? And if we've learned, what have we learned, right? Because I feel like the desire to want to make excessive amounts of money and move out the hood and take the quick path, I guess, was kind of where I know where my dad was. You know, my dad had a college degree and was teaching, but decided to hustle. I had another cousin who, you know, same thing, college degree, but decided on the side I need to get more than the money that was being offered with the current job that I had. I need it now. And I think
it's always going to be there.
Say again?
That need and that want is always going to be there. That's just a matter of how you do it. You know what I mean? You know what I'm saying?
Do you feel like we've learned from this era? Do you feel like the community's learned?
No, the community is fractured now. The community is like, I can't say blanket statements, but the black community in several different cities was even more fractured by these incidents. The laws that were changed adversely affect us. So many different people being incarcerated, so many people being murdered, you know, exacerbated black-on-black crime. I dare to say that Harlem is different because of crack now. You know what I mean? Like, it helped change the demographic of Harlem. So, and several other places around the country. So, no, I don't think people have learned from that. I think there's less solidarity among most black communities as a result of that, so.
Let's take some questions from the audience. Just say your name, where you're from, and go ahead.
Hey, good evening. Kerry D. Singleton from Intrigue Magazine. I don't think we're related, John, but Kerry D. Singleton's my name. First of all, thank you so much for Poetic Justice. I think we can all agree that that was a phenomenal historical. Thank you so much for that film, brother. My question is, what inspires you to make such innovative projects that move people and effectively change cultures?
I just kind of do what I want to see. I try to say, okay, this is a story that hasn't been told, or it hasn't been told in this way. And if I could put my bent on it, you know, put my, as I might say, my stank on it in my way, and I would do it, and that's what I go for, you know.
Next question, go ahead. Your name, where you from?
My name is Priest Forever. I'm one half of the Gecko Brothers, part of the Equilibrium Radio team. WHCR 90.3 FM in Harlem. I actually spoke to you online this week, Mr. Singleton.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I asked you, and the question that I asked was, when you teamed up with Fox FX Network to put a show on air that was going to continue to demonize black people and make us the face of this crack epidemic, you know, were you cool with that? My issue with the show, and having seen the show, it is what it is. Out of all the narratives in our history, if that was the one you wanted to tell, that's fine. My issue that I take issue with is the way it was promoted and advertised. When you watch the NBA Finals and you see three black men walking down the street and you got Run DMC playing in the back and they step on a crack bar and boom, Snowfall, this is how crack began. I could take you to 145th Street and Edge 8th Avenue right now, where around the corner, Edgecombe is one of the most crack devastated blocks in this community. And this is up. I saw that you had another woman of color, a Latina woman on a different campaign. I saw one small campaign, but those didn't come out till after the initial advertising. My issue is, you got this show. Anybody who lived through the crack epidemic isn't really going to relive that. So these millennials, these hipsters who have no point of reference, only see the advertising. Your lead actor just said, I'm from London. I only see the advertising. I watch TV. How do you answer to the cause of this imagery with the way the show is promoted perpetuates that image for black people?
Well, I love this question, actually. You know why? Because everything I've ever done, has been questioned about how I'm marketing. I go all the way back to Boys in the Hood. The trailer for Boys in the Hood made it look like an action movie, that there was only black people killing each other back in Harlem. And you went and saw it, and you saw it was much more than that. I ask you, if I had gone and said and marketed it a whole different other way, or had said and marketed it a different other way, would it have as many people watching?
Nope.
I'm not telling no documentary. If I was telling a documentary, nobody would watch. No one, we wouldn't be able to do all the different holistic stuff that I'm happy to have in the show. So,
I just say that you could have put up Ronald Reagan and Oliver North and played Madonna in the background.
No, that wouldn't have sold. Yeah. That wouldn't have sold because there's a whole lot of people, millennials, but like, they don't even know who Ronald Reagan is.
Right.
Or Oliver North, and they don't really fucking care. They don't give a fuck who Ronald Reagan is. But we're going to get to that, though. Hold on. But we're going to get, brother, we're going to get to that. You see what I'm saying? There's a whole way of getting people into the show to get them to watch the show, and then makes them have their own questions about their about history. A whole lot of people now, they don't give a fuck about what happened last week, let alone what's happening now, 20 years ago. But I know how to get folks in so that they look at the stuff and they start thinking. Because, you know, we have a thing where, like, this generation is, they're Chinese food intellectuals. They don't know shit.
Yes.
But they think they know shit off of the phone. And they don't want to investigate. They think they can say, you know, stuff is changing. Wow, they're not worried about what happened with Ronald Reagan, Oliver North. They're not worried about what happened with Lynn Bias. You know what I mean? And how those drug laws changed over one weekend. But we got to get them in there so they can watch it and see how this is all, you know, they have a deja vu. Hopefully they have a deja vu. Listen, this is how all this stuff came to be what it is around. So you have a very, very valid point about how things are marketed, this show and other stuff, but the whole idea is to get them in. And if you don't get them in, you ain't
doing
nothing.
You know what I'm saying? John, you are being provocative and providing entertainment and education all at the same time is a very delicate balance.
Absolutely.
Is that, I'm sure you consider this and walk through these steps and know these questions are coming. How does that make you feel as a creator, as a creative, walking that and balancing that, creating that?
Good. You know, I've had success in it, and I've had so-called failures that ended up being success. I made a movie over 20 years ago when I was 26 years old called Rosewood, and nobody went to see it.
I love that movie.
So when somebody says to me, you doing this, you ain't doing this movie right, I'm always like, fuck you. Don't tell me how to fuck me. I hate to say this, but when I made Rosewood, I didn't work for 4 years after that because I threatened Warner Bros. Executives, like, you know, I did the movie because I wanted black people to fight back. Okay, we're gonna do this. It was a race riot, but I'm doing it because my family and also the untold history of black people fighting back against their oppression in the South. But I threatened, they said, don't act like you're meant, your friend Spike Lee, you know. It was like, you gotta take this stuff out of the script. And I'd be like, listen, if you come down this set, I'm gonna get some blood crimps and some Muslims, whoop your ass. But that sounds funny to you, but I didn't work for many, many years until I did Shaft. You know, but I was willing to defend what I felt was right for that project. And, you know, the movie's in the Library of Congress and everything and stuff, and it's fine. You know, out of history, but I have an undercurrent of revolutionary thought in everything I do, but I don't advertise it. You know what I mean? It's like, if I advertise it, then I wouldn't be able to do what I'm doing.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? Why do I have to tell you what's my plan, what's my master plan for everything I'm trying to do? And I say, go back to saying, I don't know how many people are millennials or how many people are older people who are more informed, but as a generation, we have a responsibility to talk to the next generation and uplift them. And if you're not really doing that and you're just complaining, then you're not doing nothing.
That's right.
You know?
Yeah. I love
hard questions at home. I love it.
Can you say your name, where you're from?
Johnny Nunez, photographer. First of all, just want to, you know, congratulate everybody on stage for a really amazing show. And John Singleton for sharing with everyone, especially the millennials, about how it all started. Anyway, my question is real small. As time progresses in this show and it evolves, how will you tell the story of Gary Webb and the article Dark Alliance?
I'm not getting into Gary Webb. Gary Webb don't have nothing to do with Franklin, Gustavo, and Teddy. It's all really about the embedded thing of what these characters and how their souls are going to be whittled away by being involved in this situation. Ooh. It's all about the characters. It's all about how they evolve or devolve, and you know, dovetails and their personal losses, you know, and gains within this world. And we're following them. We're embedded following them. You know, the whole thing about it is each one of these guys, you want to see them do good, but at the same time, you're like, as good as they do, it's going to be worse for the people around them, for the world and the community. You know, and that's the interesting thing about television is that you're able to take what I call an extended narrative. You know, it's not a movie where you just, things happen in 2 hours. Things can happen over a course of seasons, and you see stuff, you know, I don't want to tell what's happening because, you know, you got to watch the show. You know, we got to get through the first season first. We only got 3 episodes. But we got plans for, you know, this can go on for, but they, you know, like 6, 7, 8 years. You know, we're starting at 83, and you know this stuff was still going on in the early 90s.
Yeah, I mean, look, there's a lot of story to tell, and we have a CIA officer in the character in the show for a reason. And we're going to go and explore all that as it blows up because, look, we all know kind of what happened, but then it's like, why did it happen? Why was it allowed to continue to happen? Why were the laws for crack cocaine so much harder than powder cocaine? There are all of these questions that I think people don't know about or are not talking about. And so I think we want to start all those conversations up over the course of years.
And real talk for the detractors, because there will be some detractors. Motherfucking people are not doing this kind of television or movies. All the movies, most of the shit on TV with black people or in movies is still that Bojangles shit. Let's just be real. Okay, so y'all can say whatever you want, whatever, but we're doing something that's elevated, that we're gonna get, that has heart and soul, the different characters, it's multi-ethnic and cool, but this don't happen. This is like, we're working with the best network around, FX, you know, you see with how Atlanta came out, right? You know what I mean? And it's funny, but it's also a mediation on contemporary black life within that city. And, you know, so we're in a very great creative space to do some really interesting stories. We're basically giving you a movie every week, you know what I mean?
Also, ladies and gentlemen, give it up for that. Also, ladies and gentlemen, we're done with the Q&A. We're going to ask that you stay in your seats because we're going to be walking the actors out to get some photos, so please stay seated. Next question, say your name, where you're from.
Hey, what's up, y'all? My name is David McFly-Vince. I'm a filmmaker, photographer, and I'm from Harlem. Actually, I grew up with Amon. Me and Mike over here, we grew up with Amon. So, definitely proud of you, Amon, for not becoming a statistic, negative statistic in our community. Now, the question that I have for you, Amon, is, what are the similarities and differences that you have between the characters that you played in the movie Dope and on Snowfall?
Dope.
Yeah, I got a curl in Snowfall. I got a beautiful curl. The curl has a name. The name of the curl is Sheila. Week to week, my curl battles against Isaiah John's character Leon, and his curl sometimes is more popular than mine. But that's pretty much the difference. Thanks for the question, bro.
The curl. What product you use? What product did y'all use on set?
I can't tell you. He wants the juice.
Oh, dear, what's the juice, man? What y'all use? The one thing.
It's the slow sheen, isn't it?
Huh? The world of curl or carefree curl? We need to know. World of curl or carefree curl? Which one?
I got the soft sheen in there a little bit, you know. Angela's a natural hair sister. Louie's a natural hair sister. Give it up to the natural hair sisters back in the day.
And one of the things that we do want to do, we think about, but we got to do in the second season, is we got it. People look on it. Amos is a boxer, so he know how he got good with his hands. We got to have character Jerome like see him nice with his hands in the show.
It touched up my curl because sometimes my joint was off and I would like Sheila to be well groomed all the time. Thank you, put that in my contract.
It's gonna be our last question here. Over here, say your name, where you're from.
Hello?
Hi. I'm just making sure it was on first. My name is Cypress Steele. Nice to meet you guys. I really like the show. This is my first time seeing it, by the way. Really, really thumbs up on that. I just noticed a lot of shadow government-y kind of vibes and underlying like things going on. I was wondering about the hide in plain sight thing. Is that gonna keep going? And do you think that this is gonna be a way for us to educate our brothers and sisters about the dangers of the concealment that the government does every day to just different things?
That's a whole long question.
Yes, but
I mean, you can't move forward unless you look at your past, if you know what I mean, you know? So this show, it's not a documentary, but you will be educated.
Ladies and gentlemen, please stay seated and give it up for the cast. Snowfall FX. Wednesdays, 10 o'clock. Thank you so much for coming out. Please stay seated.